one of the greatest minds of the 20th century, Albert Einstein, tells us of our human dilemma with this eloquent description. A human being is part of a whole, called by us the universe, a part limited in time and space. He experiences himself, his thoughts and feelings, as something separated from the rest, a kind of optical delusion of his consciousness. This delusion is a kind of prison for us, restricting us to our personal desires and to affection for a few persons nearest us. Our task must be to free ourselves from this prison by widening our circles of compassion to embrace all living creatures and the whole of nature in its beauty. Why create a park? To answer this, perhaps the words of John F. Kennedy say it best. National parks and reserves are an integral aspect of intelligent use of natural resources. It is the course of wisdom to set aside an ample portion of our natural resources as national parks and reserves, thus ensuring that future generations may know the majesty of the earth as we know it today. In the creation of parklands, one of the primary goals is the conservation of biodiversity. One of the founders of the Wildlife Conservation Society, William Hornaday, said almost 90 years ago, "The wild things of this earth are not ours to do with as we please. They have been given to us in trust, and we must account for them to the generations which will come after us and audit our accounts." One of the principal challenges in creating parklands and conservation areas is overcoming political opposition. Bob Marshall, one of the founders of the Wilderness Society, tells us, "There's just one hope of repulsing the tyrannical ambition of civilization to conquer every niche on the whole earth. That hope is the organization of spirited people who will fight for the freedom of the wilderness." Land use is highly political. There are different ideas and interests from road builders to developers of every imaginable kind. From loggers to salmon farmers, transmission line companies, ORV lobbies, dam builders, gas duct companies, ranchers, urban developers, the list goes on and on. But the development of every square meter of the territory and all of the landscapes is an unwise idea. In defining park boundaries, and although in the case of Pumalin no public land was involved, all private property rights should be religiously respected. No one should think for a minute that land use changes from the realm of development to that of conservation comes easily. It should be noted that each of the 77 national parks created in the United States generated controversy, polemics, political fights, and a conflict prior to being created. But local political opposition to parklands has best been summed up by U.S. Congressman Morris Udall when he said, "I've been through legislation creating a dozen national parks, and there's always the same pattern. When you first propose a park and you visit the area and present the case to the local people, they threaten to hang you. You go back in 5 years and they think it's the greatest thing that ever happened." To make a park, you must begin with the landscapes. In the case of Pumalin, there's a wide variety of landscapes, with high peaks on the Andean crest. There are over 86 lakes spread across Pumalin's 765,000 acres. Coastal fjords and sea level valleys of old growth forests, and rivers that empty into the sea. The landscapes run from the coast of Chile continental, over the glaciated Andes, and down into the Patagonian foothills. But to build public access infrastructure, you need people, and people with a wide variety of experience and capability. And then you have to have good design. From information and interpretive centers to campgrounds. And you need the craftsmen, the skills to work with local materials and in harmony with the landscapes. And in keeping with the regional style. Yet there is much more to the building of a park than meets the eye. Roads must be very carefully set in the landscapes. And they should be few and kept to a small scale. And this requires not just skill, but an art. Housing for park employees should be functional yet beautiful. Tourist lodging also must fit the landscapes and be cozy and comfortable. Parks require public bathrooms, showers, dishwashing and laundry facilities for visitors, and which must be easy to keep clean. There's also a need for restaurants and handicraft shops, also overlooks and picnic spots, as well as vehicular and hiking bridges, plus fences and walls of every kind. Then a network of trails for hikers and paths for houses, and even gardens and composting facilities. Parks, of course, require campgrounds, lots of them. In Pumalin, there are 28 campgrounds. Also, there are bus stop shelters and boat ramps. Energy should be produced from locally available resources. All in all, this requires years and years of work. Then there is costly restoration of areas previously degraded by former owners. For this, all kinds of heavy equipment is required. Great care has been taken in landscaping with only native species, producing an harmonious effect with structures fitting comfortably into their settings. Everything working towards a transformation to something of beauty. Some of the biggest challenges in parkland design is the signage, because it is the visual and graphic link that carries the visitor from one end of the park to the other. And to do it well, it requires good graphic design, an architect's touch, a craftsman's hand, and a builder's skill. Then when the public access infrastructure is in place, the work of administration begins, and park leadership developed, often responding to emergencies and taking on the immense job of maintenance, which becomes the primary activity going forward, for something always has to be repaired. And of course, the vegetation never stops growing. Maintenance is a never-ending endeavor. But a well-maintained and orderly park brings great appreciation from visitors. Parks provide to all citizens a chance to renew the spirit in a stressful world. Again, the words of Bob Marshall tell us, "For me and for thousands with similar inclinations, the most important passion of life is the overpowering desire to escape periodically from the clutches of a mechanistic civilization. To us, the enjoyment of solitude, complete independence, and the beauty of undefiled panoramas is absolutely essential to happiness. Parklands provide a place for reflection and contemplation. Pumalin hosts many thousands of visitors each year, coming often from urban areas to get out into nature and to have adventures, or for good companionship, as well as to camp out under the stars with real experiences, rather than a vicarious and superficial sense of nature, which cannot be compared to the beauty and real sounds of wild nature." American social critic and historian Bernard DeVoto instructs us, "It is imperative to maintain portions of wildness untouched, so that a tree will rot where it falls, a waterfall will pour its curve without generating electricity, a trumpeter swan may float in uncontaminated water, and the moderns may at least see what their ancestors knew in their nerves and blood." And each time a new park is created anywhere in the world, we can feel confident that it will be contributing in helping society understand the deep necessity to share the planet with other creatures and conserve biodiversity.